Hello, and welcome to this demonstration of cyclic symmetry modeling in Ansys Workbench Mechanical. We'll start on the Workbench project page. We could drag and drop a static structural system. We're also going to illustrate cyclic symmetry with a modal analysis. We'll drop it on the model branch because we're not going to look at pre-stressed modal analysis. We'll just use the same geometry and mesh. Let's go get a geometry, and we're going to bring in a simple sector out of a wheel. It's 1/8 of a wheel. We can now go into Workbench Mechanical at the model level. We wait while the model loads. There it is, 1/8 of a wheel, a 45 degree angle. We want to go to the coordinate systems and insert a new coordinate system. We're going to set it to be a cylindrical system. Let's name it that way so that it's easy to recognize. We go down, we indicate that the type is to be cylindrical, and we align it with the geometry for the hub of that wheel so that the z-axis points along the axis of the hub and our cyclic symmetry is going to be around the circle. Now we're going to put in a symmetry branch at the model level. Here's where we set up our cyclic symmetry. We want a cyclic region. It needs to be told what is the low boundary for that trip around a circle, and we indicate that we want our cylindrical coordinate system to be active. Here we've clicked on the low sector face, now we click on the high sector face. And that's relative to the theta direction of that coordinate system. The theta being the y, the curved green arrow. At the mesh level, we're going to indicate for that body that we would like to try multi-zone meshing. It happens that this geometry is simple enough to give successful multi-zone meshing. We'll turn up the relevance to get a little bit finer mesh. And let's see what it looks like. We generate a mesh. There it is. And that's as much mesh as we need to characterize how the entire circle works when we've represented only 1/8 of it. We're fixing the support on that hub, so the hub cannot move on its interface. We're going to put a force out on the perimeter. And for the point of illustration, we'll make it point in a tangential direction to that face. We'll set up two components in x and y. First, -1,000 in x and +1,000 in y. And you can see from the force arrow that it's running in a direction tangential to the surface. It's not running in a cylindrical direction, it's straight across, but it'll give us an in-plane deformation of this structure. We can solve the model now, and because it really is a small model, we'll get our solution fairly quickly. We can watch the solver output scroll by. Notice that it's using solid 186, 20-node bricks, because of the multi-zone mesh. And it's done. Now we can indicate the kind of results we'd like to see. Let's look at the total deformation plot. And let's also look at a von Mises equivalent stress plot. We right-click and we evaluate the results, pulling results out of the results file from the solution. There's a plot of total deformation. Notice that the mesh was just 1/8 of the model, but the computer graphics methods are used to let us see reflected pieces all the way around the structure. We can control how much that deflection is exaggerated, and we can get a better insight into the deformation if we animate it. Here it is, as if that force was ramped up and down in a static analysis. There's the stress pattern. And of course, there's stress concentration on the insides of those curves. Note that the solution is repeated sector by sector all the way around the structure. It's assumed that that force is repeated sector by sector and that the boundary condition is repeated sector by sector. We need a boundary condition for our modal analysis. We'll just drag and drop that fixed support on the inside of the hub. We're going to change the number of modes to 8. Cyclic controls, we're going to leave the harmonic index range program controlled. And at this point we've done enough to get an answer. It takes a bit longer to get a typical modal analysis carried out. It will turn out to have extracted 8 modes for each of 4 different harmonic indices. The modal solution is done, and if we go over and look at tabular data on the results, you can see modes 1 through 8 for each harmonic index. There's a shortcut to creating solutions. We go over and evaluate results for each of those solutions, and they will have been automatically set up for each of the harmonic indices and each of the modes in the solution that developed. Here we're looking at the first mode of vibration for the 0th harmonic index. Here, each sector has the same movement. There are no lines of no motion or planes of no motion in this 0th harmonic index. We get better insight if we animate the deformation. We've made it go full screen to better see the model. Here you see the first mode of vibration. This might be referred to as a breathing mode, like a chest that's breathing in and out. It turns out that the second mode of vibration for the 0th harmonic index is an in-plane deformation, something like what we saw with that tangential force. There you see it moving in the plane, and we can go to this view and see that it really is movement in the plane only. You can read the frequency. Here's a third mode of vibration, a more complex out-of-plane deformation. And being the 0th harmonic index, you'll see that it's movement out of the plane. There's the last of the 8 modes extracted in that 0th index. It's a rather complex motion, and at quite a high frequency, nearly 3000 Hz. If we move on to the 9th of these solutions, it's for the first harmonic index, and it's the first mode for that first harmonic index. If we go look at the list of results, you'll see that the frequency is repeated for modes 1 and 2 of that first harmonic index. These are degenerate eigenvalues. We have orthogonal deformations, orthogonal modes, at the same frequency. If they happen to be excited out of phase with each other, what you get is what appears to be a standing wave running around on the structure. The next one at the same frequency, it's the same deformation, but it starts 90 degrees out of phase with the first one. You only see these kinds of standing waves when we have the repeated frequencies or degenerate eigenvalues. Here we are on the second harmonic index, and there's the third. If we animate it, then once again we see that standing wave running around on the structure because there are repeated frequencies. There's the other one. It's the same frequency. It just starts out of phase with the previous one. If we go down now, we look at the last of the harmonic indices. It's harmonic index 4. You could say we've extracted 5 because there was a 0th one. If we go over to that listing, we'll see that for the highest of those harmonic indices, there are no repeated frequencies. This could be taken as a tip-off that we won't see those standing waves running around on the structure. Let's animate it and see what happens. There's the movement. the different spokes are doing different kinds of things. The thing to remember is that this analysis has been done starting out with just one of the 8 sectors, and methods are automatically deployed inside the Ansys solver to give you the solutions that you see as if the entire structure was present. Thank you for joining us. We hope you found this presentation informative.